The second and third chapters of After Virtue I take to be a project of tearing down. MacIntyre has to tackle the way of thinking that that he thinks gets in the way of being able to move forward towards some sort of moral agreement. So in chapter two, which is entitled The Nature of Moral Disagreement Today and the Claims of Emotivism, he lays out what emotivism is and begins to discuss what he thinks is wrong with it. He basically blames this school of thought of emotivism for leading to the impossibility or seeming impossibility to attain moral agreement in society. He defines emotivism as the doctrine that all evaluative judgments, and more specifically all moral judgments, are nothing but expressions of preference, expressions of attitude or feeling, insofar as they are moral or evaluative in character. And he places the origins of this way of thinking in the early 20th century, in particular in Moore's Principia Ethica. But it's treated as a more general frame of mind that society has adopted. And basically the claim is that even if a person thinks that they are reasoning morally with another person, they are really not, that whatever they say is really an expression of their feelings, and feelings are arbitrary and personal and cannot really be reasoned about. He points out some predictable problems with emotivism. The first thing he argues is that it's circular thinking, that if you probe the emotivist a little bit and you ask them what kind of feelings are you having when you say something is good or something is bad, and they will say, well, I'm having more or less moral feelings, and this doesn't really lead to any conclusion. And more, I guess more importantly or more impressively for me, he points out that emotivism denies our own perceptions of what we're doing when we talk. So basically, we have to buy into the idea that our perception that we are reasoning or attempting to reason, and that we can engage others in reason, is a sort of illusion. And that's a pretty big step to take, and it comes with implications for the way we deal with each other and with our lives generally. And indeed, we are, in his view, living with the implications, because he says that even though analytic philosophers have largely rejected the reasoning of somebody like Moore, the way of thinking about arguments as based on emotional impulses is the way that we understand our arguments. And today we can see that clearly with the outright accusations of lying and fake news and the growing cynicism, whether those are even valid categories. So he says, analytic philosophers, by and large, rejected emotivism, yet emotivism did not die. And it is important to note how often in widely different modern philosophical contexts, something very like emotivism's attempted reduction of morality to personal preference continually recurs in the writings of those who do not think of us as emotivists. So much for chapter two, because a lot more goes on in chapter three, which is entitled Emotivism, Social Content, and Social Context. We've already got the definition of emotivism, so he now argues that emotivism destroys any distinction between manipulative and non-manipulative social relations. Here he's just trying to, I think, press down on the point that he had hinted at in the second chapter, that basically, if we embrace emotivism, we're saying that all arguments are inherently manipulative and there's no real ability to reason. So he asks, what would the social world look like if we had, if we all embraced emotivism? So if we all saw each other's arguments as nothing but assertions of how they feel with no ability to actually back those assertions up with arguments and facts. Well, then he goes off onto a discussion of Max Weber and his teaching of bureaucracy and bureaucratic rationality. And he's pretty critical of Weber and the whole bureaucratic mindset. Weber is famed for making the fact-value distinction. He's certainly not the only one, but he made this distinction between facts and values, with values being something that, again, we can't control. They come up sort of organically from us, but they certainly aren't based upon reason. And so Weber's view of the world resonates deeply with emotivism and goes along with it, he argues. For bureaucratic thinking, the key here is that it's possible for people to reason about the means, how to attain something, but not to reason about the ends. And this is the way of thinking that leads to what we call technical rationality. People can be very rational about how to achieve what they value or what they say society values, but they can't reason about the values themselves. He then goes on to say that managerial authority in bureaucracies is justified on emotivist grounds. So the managerial authority at whatever level of government is what it is for no other reason than we've set it up to be an authority over us with the rules that we make at the moment based upon societal preferences that are based on nothing. He talks about the manager as a sort of stock character in bureaucratic society, who separates his role as the manager from his individual feelings and preferences. The role that you play, in which you basically perform the preset duties that have been decided, in our case, I suppose, quasi-democratically, and they may go very, very much against one's personal preferences and feelings. Well, this leads to what we call diffused responsibility, right? The idea that, well, in my role as manager, I have to follow the bureaucratic rules. And if I do so, I am not responsible. I control a certain set of means towards ends that are decided by society, and I don't have any personal responsibility for the results. But then MacIntyre further indicates that as this character becomes iconic in a society that has thoroughly embraced this way of thinking, the emotivist slash Weberian way of thinking, the social and the psychological types tend to become fused. That is, there tends to be less and less of a difference between the person's role as the, quote, manager and the person's feelings, interior feelings of right and wrong. So I take it that that means that over time, this way of thinking erases one's sense of personal responsibility and agency. He says, in our time, emotivism is a theory embodied in characters who all share the emotivist view of the distinction between rational and non-rational discourse, but who represent the embodiment of that distinction in very different social contexts. Again, the distinction that is made is that we can have rational discourse about the means, but not the ends. The ends, the goals that we have for people in society are set by feelings and personal preferences without any grounding. So there are three stock characters that he seems to think predominate in our modern society. One, the rich aesthete. Two, the manager. And three, the therapist. I'm sure there's more, but I think he picks these because they particularly grind him down, apparently. I say that because his commentary on these characters is not nice. They are characters in the cultural drama of modernity. And he says that of the therapist, who has in the last 20 years become bemused by biochemical discoveries, That of the corporate manager, who is now mouthing formulas that she or he learned in a course on business ethics while still trying to justify her or his pretensions to expertise, and that of the aesthete, who is presently emerging from a devotion to conceptual art. The last one, the person who fancies himself to be culturally knowledgeable and sophisticated, who's always going towards the latest trend or source of sophistication. And I suppose that comes from the excess wealth of a society, but also from the desire to somehow distinguish oneself within society. And here he just makes it clear, again, what the point is with these stock characters and what they see is in their purview and what is not. And again, this is very much resonates with the observations of authors like Adams and Balfour here in Unmasking Administrative Evil, where they discuss the lack of moral agency that develops in bureaucracies, leading to technical rationality and diffused responsibility. No one ultimately asks the question, is this right or wrong? They simply say, I'm doing this job. So he says neither manager nor therapist in their roles as manager or therapist do or are able to engage in moral debate. They are seen by themselves and by those who see them with the same eyes as their own, as untested figures who purport to restrict themselves to the realms in which rational agreement is possible. That is, of course, from their point of view, to the realm of fact, the realm of means, the realm of measurable effectiveness. Literally, Adams and Balfour basically connect this way of thinking to to Nazi Germany and the idea that the camp guard is just doing his job. So towards the end of the chapter, he begins to discuss what I would call the price of emotivism in society. He says, in emotivist society, we are empty, in a sense. I don't think he uses that term, but that's how I take it. We are empty or open because we are our feelings, and our feelings come and go, but yet our feelings define us. So as you know, you don't have just one set of emotions or feelings, and your feelings can change rather dramatically depending upon the situation. Well, that means if we are our feelings, if that is the most substantial part of ourselves, that we are, in effect, nothing. We are fillible. And now, so the claim of emotivism would be that we are individuals, right? Individuals with different feelings. I guess part of the democratic process, in as much as we have it, would be finding where the majority of us fall in our feelings at any given moment. But we are individuals who have nothing but feelings to express. And on the one hand, that can make us seem more individual and less embedded within society, less collective. But as Charles Taylor pointed out in A Secular Age, this type of individualism leaves us vulnerable. It's a disembeddedness from society that leaves us vulnerable because of the emptiness, because of the lack of any sort of connection to something bigger and more powerful, whether that be the communal society or whether that be some sort of religion, higher power. And that vulnerability of emptiness, of lack of direction, ultimately, then can be used for purposes of creating conformism. And this is an insight that Alexis de Tocqueville gave us back in the 19th century. MacIntyre says, more or less argues that theoretically we can define ourselves, but more likely we are defined by larger economic and political systems. And we become, at least externally, stock characters because those stock characters fit into the society and the emotivist thinking. So we become, in effect, a means to ends that are made at levels of boardrooms, at levels of the political system. But even these decisions are made on the basis, ultimately, of feelings. In the case of the boardrooms, not only the desire for profit, but the desire for control and winning. Same thing in the political world. And so you get the sense that in the emotivist society, you become more or less a gear, you know, in the machine. And no one is really at the helm. No one is deciding what levers to pull with any sort of conscious intention towards the common good. And finally, he leaves us with a bit of the pre-modern contrast, the contrasting mentality. He says, by contrast with the emotivist society in which my identity comes to the extent I have it through the feelings and maybe the feelings that I share with other people who have the same sort of feelings at any given moment, in traditional societies, the person identified himself through membership in social groups. So that might be multiple groups or basically one group. But your identity would come from membership in social groups. I am a member of this tribe and not that tribe. I am an elder. I am a warrior. I am a mother. I am a daughter. I am a child of God. These types of things. So the identity is given in a traditional society to quite an extent through where you're placed in that society. And that comes with its own problems, which we will have to discuss throughout the rest of this book. But Charles Taylor has argued, and I think Alasdair MacIntyre resonates with this argument, that embeddedness is a source of strength for the individual, because unlike in the emotivist society where the individual self is empty and therefore easily penetrated by whatever interest wants to use it, in a traditional society, the person derives a certain strength from the collective. Their identity is directed towards certain predetermined ends, and so this is the downside from the modern view. But those are ends that the person can understand and can, and usually does, buy into. In a traditional society, he says, a person's life can be objectively or impersonally assessed over the course of a lifetime as good or bad, as in, oh, she lived a good life, or she should have lived a better life. And this because people viewed life as ordered towards given ends. So it wasn't a matter of whether the individual felt that their life was good or that they were happy, but how well did that person contribute to the ends that were already given by that society? What's this got to do with Aristotle? Well, we'll see. Aristotle believed that society was not created by people so much as it grew up organically through people as political animals. And so the Aristotelian view would support more the idea of a communal or a society in which strong communal bonds could be achieved, and as we'll see, in which virtues can be defined and can be encouraged and vices discouraged. So anyway, there's a lot more to go, but you can see right now that he's established this critique of what he sees to be the modern sort of relativistic, emotivist mindset, which has led to bureaucratization, diffused responsibility, technical rationality. Those are my terms, but it does seem as though he moves in that direction. We've lost control in a way. And then he is hinting that there's this other way that we could go.